Hello friends, today I am going to begin the daily current affairs through MCQs for January 27, 2020. So question number 1 for today is, what is the rank of India in Global Competitiveness Index? Your options are 80, 78, 72, 82. The answer is 72. So the Global Talent Competitiveness Index is published by INSEAD in collaboration with HR firm Adecco and Google, in which India ranked 72, climbing 8 spots from the last ranking. So the report measures countries based on 6 pillars, that is their enability, attractability, growth, retention of talent, vocation and technical skills, and global knowledge skills. The top spot in the Global Talent Competitiveness Index is occupied by Switzerland, second spot is occupied by USA, and third by Singapore. In the BRICS grouping, China ranked 42nd, Russia ranked 48th, South Africa ranked 70th, and Brazil was at 80th position. India's highest ranked sub-pillar was employability, whereas India had a poor ability to attract and retain talent, and it is its greatest challenge. Now question number 2. Recently, Oslo Peace Accord is in news. What does it relate to? Option A, North Korea-USA affairs. Option B, Taliban-USA affairs. Option C, Middle East peace plan of USA. And option D, Israel-Palestine affairs. So the answer is Israel-Palestine affairs. Now the Oslo Accords, they are a landmark moment in the pursuit of peace in Middle East. So a set of 2 separate agreements were signed by Government of Israel and the leadership of Palestine Liberation Organization or PLO, which was established in 1964 to create Palestine. So the negotiation between Israel and PLO that ultimately led to Oslo Accords began in Oslo in Norway in 1993. The Oslo Accords were ratified twice, once in Washington DC in 1993, which are also known as Oslo 1, and second time in Taba, Egypt in 1995, which is called Oslo Accord 2. So the interim agreement or the Oslo 2, which was signed at Taba in 1995, set out the scope of Palestine Authority in West Bank and Gaza. Now the interim pact, which was signed in 1995, was supposed to last only 5 years, while a permanent agreement was finalized. But it has tacitly been rolled over for more than 2 decades. Now you must be wondering why we are studying the Oslo Accords today. Now why is it in news? It is in news because Palestine officials have threatened to withdraw from key provisions of Oslo Accord, which define the relationship with Israel, if US President Donald Trump announces his Middle East peace plan next week. Now question number 3. India has signed an agreement with which country to upgrade Ashuganj-Akhura road into 4-lane highway? Options are Nepal, China, Bangladesh, Pakistan. So the answer is Bangladesh. Now India has recently signed an agreement with Bangladesh to upgrade 50.58 km road between Ashuganj River Port and Akhura in Bangladesh into a 4-lane highway. Now it is a part of $2 billion line of credit that is extended by India to Bangladesh in 2016. Out of this 50.58 kilometer, a stretch of 39 kilometer would be upgraded by Roads and Highways Department of Bangladesh and an Indian company, AFCONS Infrastructure Limited. The Roads and Highway Department of Bangladesh and an India-Bangladesh joint venture firm will take up the work of upgrading the remaining part of the road. The project is expected to improve the road connectivity between India and Bangladesh and facilitate a regional connectivity between South and Southeast Asian countries. Now next question. Government of India has signed an agreement with which multinational corporation to improve the performance of GSTN filling portal? Your options are TCS, Infosys, Wipro or Birlasoft. So the answer is Infosys. Now, government has recently signed an agreement with Infosys to improve the performance of GSTN filling portal. Infosys is the managed service provider for GST regime in India. Now, to improve access and performance of GSTN filling portal on a permanent basis, some technological changes are being carried out by Infosys, and these changes are expected to be operational by April 2020. Next question, which zone of the Indian Railways has commissioned first waste-to-energy plant? Your options are Eastern Railways, North Central Railways, West Coast Railways and East Coast Railways. So the answer is East Coast Railways. Now East Coast Railways has commissioned the government's first waste-to-energy plant. Now, this is the first of its kind in Indian Railways and only the fourth plant in India. This plant will turn e-waste and plastic into a light diesel oil in less than 24 hours. A new technology called Polycrack, which was recently patented, will be used in this waste-to-energy plant. There was a large pile of non-ferrous scrap which was generated from carriage repair workshop and which could not be efficiently disposed earlier and was causing environmental hazards. So to overcome that problem, this waste to energy plant has been created. Now those non-ferrous scrap can be converted into hydrocarbon, liquid fuels, gas, carbon and water in this waste to energy plant. Now you must be wondering, what is the Polycrack technology? So Polycrack technology is the world's first patented heterogeneous catalytical process which will convert multiple feedstock into hydrocarbon, liquid fuels, gas, carbon and water. Now question number 6. The country's first super fabrication laboratory is to be set up in which state? Options are Gujarat, Uttar Pradesh, Andhra Pradesh, Kerala. So the answer is Kerala. Now the country's first super fabrication lab was recently launched at the Integrated Startup Complex of Kerala Startup Mission or KSUM. So the facility was inaugurated by Chief Minister of Kerala Pinari Vijayan. Now this fabrication lab, which is the only such facility outside the United States of America, will function in collaboration with Massachusetts Institute of Technology or MIT. Now the KSUM Super Fab Lab consists of 10,000 square feet area and has a state-of-art machines worth more than 7 crores. This lab will enable the state to produce machines locally and thus will boost the hardware industry. Now question number 7. Consider the following statements with reference to Jal Shakti Abhiyan and Jal Jeevan Mission. Statement 1. Jal Shakti Abhiyan is a countrywide effort to enhance water security, especially in water stressed districts. Second statement is, Jal Jeevan Mission aims to provide individual household water tap connection to every rural household in the country by 2024. Now, which of the above statements are correct? Option A, 1 only. Option B, 2 only. Option C, both 1 and 2. And option D, neither 1 nor 2. So the answer is both 1 and 2. Now Jal Shakti Abhiyan is a countrywide effort to enhance water security, especially in the water stressed districts. Now Jal Shakti Abhiyan aims at making water conservation and promotion of irrigation efficiency a public campaign through asset creation and communication campaigns. Now the map attached here shows the blocks where the measure will be carried out. The districts in the red are districts with water stressed blocks, or these are also called non-aspirational districts. And the yellow districts are districts with water stress, which are aspirational districts. Now the program Jal Shakti Abhiyan is a time-bound, mission mode, water conservation and irrigation efficiency campaign for rural water security in rural India. So the Jal Shakti Abhiyan will run from ran from July 1 to September 15, 2019. Now during that time, the officers, groundwater experts, scientists, etc. work together with the state and district officials in the country's water-stressed districts for water conservation, resource management and irrigation efficiency. So the intervention included water conservation and rainwater harvesting, renovation of water bodies, renovation of borewell recharge structures, intensive afforestation and the watershed development. Whereas when we talk about the Jal Jeevan Mission, now Jal Jeevan Mission aims to provide individual household water tap connection to every rural household in the country by 2024. So the Jal Jeevan Mission is said to be based on various water conservation efforts like point recharge, desilting of minor irrigation tanks, use of grey water for agriculture and source sustainability. Now question number 8. What is the process of breeding crops with higher levels of vitamins, minerals or higher protein and healthier fat known as? So the options are allelopathy, biofortification, hybridization and bioaccumulation. The answer is biofortification. So biofortification is breeding crops with higher levels of vitamins and minerals or higher protein and healthier fat. Biofortification is undertaken with the objective of improved protein content and quality, or improved oil content and quality, then vitamin content in the crops, or micronutrient and mineral content in the crops. So why this is a news? This is a news because Rajasthan will be fortifying the midday meal. Question number 9. Which of the following statements about hydrofluorocarbons is correct? Statement 1. India has successfully achieved the complete phase out of hydrofluorocarbons HCFC 141V, which is a chemical used by foam manufacturing enterprises. Option 2. Before the phase out of hydrofluorocarbon 141B, India was one of the major producers of HCFC 141B. Option 3. The complete phase out of HCFC 141B from the country is agreed under Montreal Protocol on substances that deplete the ozone layer. So which of these options are correct? Option A, 1 and 2 only. Option B, 2 and 3 only. Option C, 1 and 3 only. Option D, all of the above. So the answer is 1 and 3 only. So India has successfully achieved the complete phase out of hydrofluorocarbons 141B, which is a chemical that was used by foam manufacturing enterprises and was one of the most potent ozone depleting chemical after CFCs. Now HCFC 141B is mainly used as a blowing agent in the production of rigid polyurethane or PU foams. Now HCFC 141B is not produced in the country and all domestic requirements are met only through imports. Now with this notification prohibiting the import of HCFC 141B, the country has completely phased out the important ozone depleting chemical. Simultaneously, the use of HCFC 141B by foam manufacturing industry has also been closed as on 1st January 2020 under the Ozone Depleting Substances Regulation and Control Amendment Rules 2014. Nearly 50% of the consumption of ozone depleting chemicals in the country was attributable to HCFC 141B in the foam sector. So the complete phase out of HCFC 141B from the country in foam sector is one of the first at this scale in Article 5 parties or developing countries under the Montreal Protocol. So now next question. Which of the following statements are correct about the Bodo Accord recently signed by the government? Statement 1. A commission will be set up for the inclusion of Bodo-dominated villages in the Bodoland Territorial Council and exclusion of those where the Bodos were not in a majority. Statement 2. This is the second Bodo Accord to be signed in last 27 years. Your options are Statement 1 is correct, Statement 2 is correct, both Statement 1 and 2 are correct, and D, neither Statement 1 nor 2 is correct. So the answer is only the Statement 1 is correct. Now let us see something about Bodo Accord. So a tripartite accord for final settlement of demands in Bodo land was signed on January 27, 2020 in New Delhi. Now the Bodo land will now be named as Bodo Land Territorial Region or BTR and will have more administrative powers. Cadres of all the four factions of NSFB will lay down the arms on January 30. Now, Union Home Minister Amit Shah has announced that the tripartite agreement will restore peace and development in the insurgency-ravaged area of Bodo land. A commission will be set up for inclusion of Bodo-dominated villages in the Bodoland Territorial Council and exclusion of those where the Bodos were not in a majority. Now, this is the third Bodo Accord to be signed in last 27 years. A total of 1,550 NDFB cadres along with 130 weapons will surrender in a ceremony on January 30, Home Minister Amit Shah has said. Now, a special package of 900 crores has been granted by the centre for overall development of Bodo land areas. Besides this, the government will assure the Bodo groups to safeguard Bodo language and culture. Bodo language will now be an associate official language with Devanagari script in Assam. Now, accord at a glance, the number of seats in Bodo land territorial administrative BTAD will be increased from 40 to 60. A central university will be set up at Barama in the name of Upendranath Brahma. A special industry policy for Bodo land territorial administrative district. Then a railway coach factory to be set up in Bodo land territorial administrative district area. Then Sports Authority of India will have a center at Udalguri, Baksa and Chirang. DC and SC, SP will be appointed in consultation with BTC authority. Then a national sports university will also be set up in the Bodoland territorial area. Then autonomous welfare council for Bodo people living outside BTAD areas will also be set up. A cancer hospital and a medical college will be set up at Tamalupur. The Government of India has expedite the process of granting hill tribe status to Bodos living in the hill areas. Then besides this, a veterinary college will be set up in Kumarikata and a central university and RIIMS will be set up at Udalguri. And a special industry policy will be made for Bodoland territorial area districts. Now this is all in the news today. Thank you so much. If you like the video, please click the subscribe button and press the notification bell. Please share and like the video. Thanks a lot.